Good afternoon, friends. Welcome to this closing session. Dr. Sameh Fauzi, please look outside and tell our friends we're about to start. We are reaching the final session, and well, that's a very nice thought. Thank you for somebody to say too bad after a long 3 days shows either enormous stamina or a masochistic tendency, whichever is. But I would like to think it's stamina and that you're being inspired, and I thank you for that. I would like to start out this session. We have two speakers, and then myself, I will just say a few wrap-up conclusions at the end. And before I introduce my speakers, I'd like to say two things. First, that frequently, even though we think that we are sensitive and that we are thoughtful and that we understand others, sometimes one speaks in a way where not only one miscommunicates with the other party, but can in fact hurt them and offend them. And I have been guilty of this earlier today. And contrary to the situation where one would hurt someone in public and then apologize in private, I have hurt someone in private and I would like to apologize in public. My friend Rasad Hussain, who represents the United States to the OIC, and I were having a discussion. And I spoke to him in a tone that appeared to him to be dismissive. And I apologize for that. That certainly was not my intention. But it is a useful reminder for part of this whole conference and part of this whole issue that much of what we hear and see from each other is things we project onto the others, and sometimes we are not conscious of our own errors. And so as not to turn it into something too serious, I will borrow a joke from a great American, General Jones. I just heard that joke in Washington when I was with him, and I think it's very pertinent to what we're talking about. And he goes to the doctor, and he says to the doctor, "I am worried about my wife." And he says, "What's wrong with your wife?" He says, "I think she's losing her hearing. She doesn't hear well, and could this be the beginning of a degenerative disease or something wrong with her, or what's the story?" So the doctor said, "Yes, that could be the beginning of something, but just make sure that this is the case. So why don't you do a test?" And he said, "What is the test?" And he said, "Well, you just go stand behind her and say something in a normal voice and see if she hears you and responds or not." So he says, "Very well." He knows that his wife is failing to hear. So he goes home and he stands about 20 feet from her, behind her, as she's in the kitchen. And he says, "Honey, what's for dinner?" No reaction. So he comes closer another 10 feet and he says, "Honey, what's for dinner?" No reaction. So this really is getting serious. So he comes within 5 feet of her and says, "Honey, what's for dinner?" So she turns around and says, "For the third time, spaghetti." Actually, there's a profound meaning to this story. Frequently, we think that the other people are not hearing us, but we're not hearing them. We project that the fault is with them when the fault could be with us. And I think, therefore, it is pertinent that at least in the last few days we've had a very interactive dialogue and we've had intensive discussions. And I think not only have we heard each other, but I have here a number of proposals for actions that are going to be born out of these meetings, including a beautiful proposal from Yale University that we will be engaging in a beautiful program for translation and exchange of ideas within and among civilizations. We've had a beautiful discussion with Peter Weller and others about making films to communicate civilization with others. We've had a special program to relaunch Youth for Change, a program that we had done initially with Canada, but with also the United States, to have Arab youth and American youth work jointly on IT projects that would be welcomed. Educational programs have evolved. So we have budding beginnings of possible collaborations in education, science, and culture. And it is a promise from me to all of you that my colleagues and I will take all of this and we will put forward these ideas in more structured form. We'll communicate with all of you, and those who want to join particular projects will be more than welcome. It's a broad tent and matchmaking as much as possible for real collaborations and real projects in education, science, and culture is where it's going. And so, to bring this session to a conclusion, I would like to start by inviting my good friend, whom I've just apologized, I certainly didn't mean anything, I invite my good friend Rashad Hussein, the U.S. Special Envoy to the Organization of Islamic Conference, to give us his reflections. He will be then followed by Mohammed bin Saleh, representing the Director General of ISESCO, and then I will not abuse, but I will claim the privileges of the chair to wrap up with a concluding statement. So, Mr. Rashad Hussein, please.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Wa salatu wa salam ala Rasulihi al-Ameen wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'een. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. First of all, I wanted to thank the Dr. Ismail for hosting us here at this wonderful event. It's from his magnificent introduction at the beginning, one of the best lectures that I've heard since I was in university myself, and I heard colleagues make the same remarks to the wonderful tour which he gave us of this magnificent institution. We really appreciate it, and if we have no other chance, then I think we should all take the opportunity now to please appreciate the host, Maktab al-Iskandariya, this institution, which will be, inshallah, a beacon of light in the same way in which Al-Azhar has been for so many years. This is one of the most remarkable things that we have seen since the Cairo speech, is that in addition to initiatives that the government tries to implement, that the Americans try to implement, that we work with other countries in implementing, is that there's so many of these wonderful symposiums and conferences which have produced tremendous recommendations, and this is certainly no exception. And I congratulate everyone here for all of the recommendations that come out of this event, and look forward to working with all of you. The United States acknowledges, the government acknowledges all the time, the president acknowledges all the time, that it's not primarily the government that comes up to with solutions to these problems. It comes from the people. And the government is always not the best, is often not the best avenue for addressing these problems. And this is another wonderful example of how it's actually these types of institutions and you all that will come up with the best solutions to all of these issues. Growing up in the United States as a Muslim American, I see myself in the same shoes as many of you in the audience today. The concerns that I've heard throughout this conference, the concerns that I've heard in the sessions, in the question and answer, are many of the same concerns that I have had for many years as a Muslim and as American. And I was one of the people in the United States that was inspired by the president's message during the campaign. And it's a little bit different when you get involved and you start working in government. You start seeing that you can't exactly do everything that you want to do the way you want to do it, as when you're a person out here in the audience that sees themselves more kind of as an activist or somebody that's really pushing the government. Things are a little bit slower sometimes in government, but I wanted to go through what I think we've tried to achieve and give kind of an honest assessment of that. And there's areas where I think we've made a lot of good progress, and there's areas where, there's a very high standard. There's a lot of expectations, and you should continue to hold us to those expectations, and we'll continue to do whatever we can to meet those expectations. And, you know, the president noted an ayah from the Quran that's noted by the khatib in the khutbah. Towards the beginning of the khutbah, and the president noted himself, Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu taqullaha wa qulu qawlan sadida. O people of consciousness, speak always the truth. And this is what the president tried to do, and this is what I'll try to do in being frank of the assessment of what we've tried to accomplish over the last year. I think there's been three primary areas of progress in the year since the Cairo speech. The first is that there's been a fundamental shift in tone, a fundamental shift in the paradigm, in the approach that the United States has towards Muslim communities all around the world. And that is a new framework, a new rhetoric, a new way of thinking that highlights the contributions of Muslims all around the world. It highlights the contributions of Muslim civilizations from the beginning of time, really, the contributions of Muslim Americans in the United States, and a way which counters misperceptions about Islam and Muslims. That hasn't been done, I think, in previous years, and that's coming straight from the President of the United States himself, who made it clear in Cairo that you cannot engage one-fourth of the world's population based on the fringe beliefs of a few people, who made it clear that when it comes to the problem of violent extremism, Islam is not the problem, but it's actually a part of the solution, and who made it clear that we should engage Muslims not just based on the Middle East or not just based on violent extremism, but based on all issues that people all fundamentally care about. Whether it's when you survey people in this country or anywhere in the world, they'll tell you, when you ask them what's their number one concerns, they'll say it's jobs. Or they'll say it's education or healthcare. And with that fundamental reality, we should be engaging people based on those things. And we shouldn't just look at Muslims and say, okay, let's talk about security. Let's talk about the Middle East. Those are important issues. And the administration in no way will try to work around those issues or sidestep those issues. We understand that unless we come up with good solutions to those problems, that advancing the ball in other areas will be difficult, highlighting accomplishments in other areas will be difficult. But if we have a two-track approach in which we try to tackle the political problems and at the same time try to create partnerships, that one day, inshallah, we'll be able to look back and say, that was an era where we came up with good solutions to these political problems and we planted the seeds long-term for the partnerships and the types of partnerships that this conference has tried to bring about. So the second area, and I've already mentioned it, is progress in key political areas. And I'll go through kind of the chronology since Cairo, and included in that will be an assessment of the political challenges and the solutions that we've tried to implement. The third is the creation of a number of partnerships in many areas, including education, entrepreneurship, health, science, technology, interfaith dialogue. A lot of the partnerships that have been implemented, they haven't been the most high-profile things. They're not the things that you read about in the front pages of the paper, but they are there, and we have started on them. And we think that they really will lay the foundation for cooperation and in a way that maximizes prosperity when we're able to reach peaceful solutions, and even before that, to many of these conflicts. The president, of course, began this outreach to Muslim communities all around the world on the day of the inauguration. And he was the first president to speak directly to Muslim communities all around the world when he reached out and talked about the need for understanding and the need for respect between the United States and Muslim communities around the world. To recognize that and to make it one of the top foreign policy priorities of the administration, I think was significant in and of itself. And on the first day in office, he addressed a couple of the issues that have been at the forefront of tensions in those areas. One was the president banned torture immediately. And we know when we look back at some of the things that have happened in previous years, that's been one of the most hurtful things we've seen, one of the biggest sources of tension. And I think it's significant that the United States no longer is allowed by law, because of that executive order, to engage in the practice of torture. And that's something that was done on the first day in office, recognizing that not only it's wrong, but it's also an ineffective tactic. Also on the same day, the president pledged to close Guantanamo Bay through an executive order on the first day in office. This is something that's a difficult task. Again, this is an area where we have to be honest. I think we've made tremendous progress reviewing each file of each detainee, the remaining detainees, the toughest cases. 33 of them so far have been transferred to other countries, which is a high number in comparison with the number that was transferred in previous years. And the commitment remains to closing Guantanamo and to go through each one of those cases and evaluate them carefully and one by one. There's a lot of work left to be done there, but it's our mission and our goal to make sure that Guantanamo is closed and that all those cases are taken care of in as quickly and most responsible fashion as possible. The second day in office, the president, of course, addressed one of the issues that remains a fundamental area of tension and an issue that comes up over and over again in all these forums, including this weekend. Although it's a forum in which we're concentrating on culture and education and science, it's an issue that we've heard about even in the last session, and that is the issue of the Middle East. This is an area, of course, where we've had ups and downs and difficulties over the last 60 years in trying to come up with a solution to this. But the president's approach was to recognize from day one that this is a tough issue that requires a lot of time to work on. And so rather than waiting till the end of his first term or waiting till a second term, on his second day in office, appointed Senator Mitchell, who has been in the region on a monthly basis, has had now two rounds of proximity talks in an effort to get to direct negotiations that will be, we hope, inshallah, the source of a breakthrough, finally. In the problem of the Middle East. And we've seen just in the last weeks the difficulties and the events that will inevitably arise as long as there's not a just solution to that conflict. And really, what I think you'll see, this beginning with the announcement that the president made last week of $400 million in additional aid to the Palestinian territories, is that this has really galvanized the efforts to get the peace process going, to get the direct talks going, and to really put ourselves in a position where we can achieve a breakthrough in the solution. There is not enough that has been done on this issue. We have liked to have made more progress, but the president has said repeatedly that this is an issue that's of great importance to him, and I think that you'll see, inshallah, that he will continue to be persistent on this issue, that he won't use events like the event that occurred 2 weeks ago as an excuse to walk away from it, that he will continue at it and continue at it and continue at it, just like he did with healthcare. When people said, well, you haven't had health care for 70 years, how nobody was able to do it, and how people repeatedly said health care is dead, health care won't pass, it's impossible. People are saying the same types of things about the Middle East now, but I think that you'll see with the president's persistence and passion on this issue that, inshallah, we'll be able to look back and say that this was the presidency in which there was a breakthrough. I wish it had happened in the first year, but I think the president has given us enough time, we hope, to achieve a breakthrough sometime in the first 4 years and potentially in the 8 years of his presidency. Of course, after that, the first couple of days in office, the president, one of the first things he did to reach out to the Muslim world was the first interview which he gave was an interview with Al Arabiya, as his intention to reach out and show how much of a issue of importance it is for his foreign policy objectives. And in the same light, in his first trip that the president made, the last stop on that trip was to Ankara. And in that speech, he addressed bilateral relationships with Turkey, but he also addressed the Muslim world and made it very clear that the United States is not at war with Islam. And in fact, the president said himself when he was giving that speech, not only is the United States not at war with Islam, but he said himself, and will never be at war with Islam. And I think it spoke to the conviction and the sincerity that he has, that he spoke on that issue and inserted that point, that the United States will never be at war with Islam. And to make that clear and the basis of the framework, and to detach ourselves from the years past in which there had been that widespread perception. We all know that one of the next trips that the president made was to Cairo, and that's where he gave his historic speech in which he outlined the contributions of American Muslims, of Muslims to global civilizations, in which he made clear that the United States is not at war with Islam and will never be, that Islam is a part of the solution when it comes to violent extremism. And when he honestly went through the areas of tension, some of which remain in our relationships with Muslims all around the world, and then outline some areas of partnership, which I'll address in detail. So that was kind of during the first few months of the presidency, kind of the international focus that existed. I think it's also important to note, and this may not be reported so much in international circles, but the president and the administration has done a tremendous amount to reach out to Muslim communities at home in the United States too. And one of the first ways he did that, in addition to the inauguration, was, as you know, the Islamic Society of North America is one of the largest gathering of Muslims around the world. And in previous administrations, there's been some hesitancy to attend that conference. But not only did the United States government send a representative to that conference, the president sent one of his closest advisors to address that convention, Valerie Jarrett. And there she also highlighted many of the points that the president made in Cairo and talked about the contributions of American Muslims. Also, the president sent his top Homeland Security Advisor, John Brennan, to speak at the Islamic Center at NYU to engage that community as well as a part of that continuing domestic dialogue. And as a part of the continuing dialogue at the White House, we've continually had meetings with domestic Muslim communities, not just on the issues of counterterrorism or security, but really there's been engagement with American Muslims on the issues of healthcare, education, immigration, in which there's been a constant dialogue, and we've seen the valuable contributions of American Muslims in all of those areas. You may remember then at the beginning of Ramadan that the president gave kind of a speech at the beginning that he gave by video at Ramadan, but it was kind of in the role as, you might say, educator-in-chief, where he talked about in that speech to the world that the significance of Ramadan and the common roots that it has, the values that they're shared by people of all faith, that the president mentioned that the first word that was revealed, iqra, which he mentioned, of course, in Arabic, as the first word that was revealed in the Quran, and the Ramadan, of course, being the month in which the Quran was revealed, and continuing to play that kind of educating role. At the White House, the president during the month hosted an iftar, in which not only were there ambassadors invited, but Muslim Americans from across the country. Two of the people that sat with the president at his table, just to give you an example, one of the persons who was sitting on his right was a woman who is from a high school in Massachusetts, who is the leading scorer in the history of Massachusetts basketball, female, fully covered when she plays basketball. He sat next to her, the president being a big fan of basketball. On the other side was a woman who had been denied the right by her school in Oklahoma to wear the hijab, and the Justice Department in the United States defended her right in court to wear the hijab and won that freedom. And those were the two of the main people that the president was talking to during the iftar to really engage not just the ambassadorial kind of crowd, but American Muslims in general. And the president continued to play that same role around the time of Hajj when he talked about the root, the reasons why Muslims from all around the world, 3 million people come together for Hajj, the purpose of that, the common Abrahamic roots of that, and continued kind of that role as educator-in-chief. And I think all of these efforts, just the educational role, just taken by itself, if you just look at that for the first year, aside from the progress in the political areas and the progress in the partnerships that I'll talk about, I think that's significant. And not only distancing ourselves from kind of the past rhetoric towards Muslims but by reaching out to Muslims and kind of diminishing the sense of otherization that some American Muslims may have felt in the past, or Muslims around the world may have felt, to try to decrease that and to, again, extend out. Of course, there's a lot of work to do in that regard, but these are some of the efforts that have been made. And all of these efforts during the first year have come in the face of those who have said that maybe we shouldn't be doing this. Maybe we should cut back on our relations with Muslim communities. Why are we engaging? After the Fort Hood massacre in Texas, the terrorist attack in Texas, people made that claim. But the president went to Texas, and at the eulogy for those soldiers that died, he said that this action that has occurred is something that's rejected by not only Muslims, but by people of all faith. And the person that committed those acts will receive their justice in this life and in the next life. And he did the same thing again after the 25th of December, when there was another attempted terrorist attack on the United States. And he made clear that that's something that's rejected by Muslims, and that the fact is that the largest victims of those types of attacks, over 85 to 90% in the previous years, have been Muslims. Muslims are the ones that suffer from this the most. And to raise that point, again, distances us from the idea that this is some concept of Islam versus the West. It's actually an area that we need to solve because Muslims are the greatest victims. And again, of course, after the recent Times Square bombing, the president again made the same point at West Point, the academy where many of our young soldiers train before they go off to serve. And he made that point to the young soldiers that no one should interpret what happened in Times Square as we should never give in to this idea that of those who try to divide us and try to create this division between Islam and the West. So those are the general areas of engagement. To get into a little bit more specific about what has been delivered in the political areas, I talked about the Middle East conflict, and it's an area where we're continuing to persist in the manner that I mentioned, and I think that we'll see in the next few weeks. There was a positive announcement by Israel just yesterday and we've been in constant communication with Israel about making sure that goods are allowed into Gaza in a manner which is consistent with their security. And there was somewhat of a positive announcement yesterday that there's going to be an ease on some of those restrictions. And I think you'll continue to see, as we follow this conflict over the next few months, progress in that area. In the area of Iraq, which of course was one of the largest areas of tension throughout the previous years, the previous decade, I think this is an area where, again, we can see that the United States is moving in a way which was definitely promised. After the last month, there's 90,000 combat troops remaining, and at the end of August, the number of troops will be down to 50,000. That will end the combat mission in Iraq. And the goal is, by the end of next year, to have the troops out of Iraq and the power responsibly transferred to the Iraqi government. That's the vision and the timetable that we're following in Iraq. It's similar in Afghanistan, where I think we're following a similar timetable in our efforts to partner with the Afghani people and transfer authority back to them. So the long-term vision in many of these political areas is, as I said earlier, is to create a situation in which we look back and we see that over the course of the first term of the presidency, that the United States continued and persisted and got out of Iraq, transferred power in Afghanistan, and achieved some type of breakthrough in the Middle East. At the same time, of course, are these key areas of partnership which have been the focus of this conference. And those areas are areas that the president mentioned as being areas that are areas really of mutual respect, mutual interest, areas where all people around the world fundamentally care about. So let's start with the area of education. In the area of education, we've exchanged educational exchanges by approximately 30%. And there's been a number of really unique exchange programs that have taken place. We have a document, which is a fact sheet on everything that's been, many of the examples of things that have been implemented since Cairo that I have here, and we'll have a number of them outside that just go through many of the examples of the projects that have been implemented. There's been through NASA, for example, an exchange by which Arab youth will come and Arabs and Muslim young scholars will come and train at NASA. Just to give you an example, the fact that it's not just the State Department that's involved or that it's not just the Commerce Department or USAID, but really getting involved in unique ways, like through NASA with this exchange program. There's an online exchange program that's been started with Bahrain. There's limitations on physical exchanges. Only about 1.5% of Americans are able to go abroad themselves and engage in physical exchanges. So there's an importance of having online exchanges as well, by which students in American classrooms can exchange ideas with students in classrooms all over the world. They can work collaboratively on projects, on problem solving, and that's the basis of the partnership with Bahrain. In the area of entrepreneurship, the second area, the president promised in Cairo to host a summit on entrepreneurship. And that summit was hosted in the United States a couple of months ago, which brought together about 250 entrepreneurs from all over the world, many of them from Muslim-majority countries. And there was a lot of unique stories that came out of that. The president highlighted many of them in his remarks. One of the best examples was there was a Palestinian woman who was offered a full scholarship by the dean of the Boston College School of Business. He was so impressed with her at the Entrepreneurship Summit that he offered her that scholarship on the spot. And we've seen in the last few weeks and in the last couple of months, in fact, that many of these students that have gone home have really increased awareness of entrepreneurship. Of course, entrepreneurship being one of the key drivers of economic growth and economic development and social development all over the world. So I think there's been a lot of progress made in encouraging entrepreneurship, and I think that's consistent with some of the initiatives that have come out of this conference as well. In the area of health, the United States has partnered, as you know, with the Organization of the Islamic Conference on an initiative in polio. Polio being endemic in four countries in the world, three of them Muslim countries, Afghanistan, Pakistan, and Nigeria. And the fourth country, the area in which polio has been most endemic is in areas where there's Muslim majority populations, the areas where my parents happen to come from in India, Bihar and UP. And we've seen, alhamdulillah, over the last year, if you look at the number of new cases in polio, in Nigeria, for example, there was only three new cases in the first quarter, and that's a significant improvement from the previous years. Something so simple, something so inexpensive, 60 cents each polio vaccination, the potential for cooperation, again, in the area of health, which is one of the things that's been highlighted at this conference and some of the initiatives that hopefully will continue to come out. Another one of the partnerships that we've been involved in health has been with the Saudi ministry prior to the Hajj this year. We had a partnership on H1N1. As you know, there was a big scare before Hajj this year. It was during the H1N1 season that it would become a problem amongst the Hujjaj, then also when they came back home. So there was a strong partnership created that we hope was one of the reasons that averted that type of disastrous event at Hajj this year. Just a couple of the areas of partnership that we've had in health. There's been other areas of partnership in health, and in the area, for example, of science and technology, there's been a number of partnerships. As you know, we've spoken about this throughout the conference. Our science envoys, for example, Ahmed Zuhail, Bruce Alberts, and Elias Zarhouni have traveled extensively throughout the Muslim world and have been establishing programs and recently came up with their recommendations that were given to the president and presented to establish a number of programs in the area of science and technology. There's a number of areas we can go through, whether it's the Global Technology and Innovation Fund, which will establish over $3 billion, in fact, of funding for technology programs throughout the region and in the Muslim world, as an example of the partnerships that we have in science. There's a clean energy partnership with the King Abdulaziz City Science and Technology Institute in Saudi Arabia, by which we have cooperation in creating clean energy products. And finally, in the area of interfaith partnerships, there's also been a number of initiatives that have come out as well during the first year, one of them being a major conference that was held in Jakarta with religious leaders from all around the world. There is a White House effort in which we have a working group on religion and global affairs, in which we're tracking the positive impact of interfaith partnerships and interfaith dialogues all over the world and looking to expand those in different areas. We have a upcoming conference on engaging Muslims in development, which will be held in the Middle East sometime in the next year. And there's also an initiative underway to train U.S. government personnel on the importance of religion in this part of the world and to sensitize them to many of those considerations that exist. So as you can see, these are some of the areas in education and science and health and technology, interfaith dialogue, environment, which we've created a number of partnerships in the first year as we work through a lot of the political problems and political challenges that exist, and which are, of course, the basis for many of the initiatives that have come out of this conference as well. And while we continue to work on those, it really will be many of the private efforts of groups like this university, people like you, that will continue to move forward on many of these partnerships. Finally, I just wanted to highlight one last point, and that is that it's consistent with kind of the fundamental shift in the way that the United States views Muslims around the world, communicates with Muslims around the world, engages with Muslims around the world. That was articulated as the basis of the framework in Cairo. Recently, the United States government issued its national security strategy. And this is a hugely important document. This was a document in the previous administration which, for example, laid out the strategy of preemptive war, which many of us are familiar with. That is not a part of the new national security strategy, but that's not the area that I wanted to highlight in the new national security document. In outlining and rolling out this new national security strategy at the Center for Strategic and International Studies recently, the President's Homeland Security and Counterterrorism Advisor, John Brennan, talked about the counterproductive nature of describing Muslims only in the context of violent extremism and using terms like Islamic terrorism to describe these types of activities. And I'll just read as the point to leave you with the analysis and kind of the framework by which you'll see that the administration's approach has fundamentally changed towards dealing with these issues. This is what John Brennan said there. Nor do we describe our enemy as jihadists or Islamists, because jihad is a holy struggle, a legitimate tenet of Islam, meaning to purify oneself of one's community. And there is nothing holy or legitimate or Islamic about murdering innocent men, women, and children. Indeed, characterizing our adversaries this way would actually be counterproductive. It would play into the false perception that they are religious leaders defending a holy cause when, in fact, they are nothing more than murderers, including the murder of thousands upon thousands of Muslims. That is why Muslim leaders around the world have spoken out forcefully and often at great risk to their own lives to reject al-Qaeda and violent extremism. And frankly, their condemnations often do not get the recognition they deserve, including from the media. Moreover, describing our enemy in religious terms would lend credence to the lie propagated by al-Qaeda and its affiliates to justify terrorism, that the United States is somehow at war with Islam. The reality, of course, is that we have never been and never will be at war with Islam. After all, Islam, like so many faiths, is part of America. And I think that this kind of sums up the new approach that we've seen that has allowed us to have a framework for partnership and partnerships in so many productive areas. And I hope that you'll find this to be an assessment that I feel highlights some of the positive things that have happened. I know that there is much more work to do in the 4 years and hopefully 8 years that this administration is in power. I think we've seen, these are some of the results that we've seen over the first year, and with your help, we hope to carry that forward, inshallah, and see the fruits of this labor and solutions to all of these conflicts and problems that have been outlined and partnerships in all of the areas that have come out of this conference. Thank you very much. Assalamu alaikum.
Thank you, Hassan Rashad, for this very extensive and thoughtful presentation. I would like now to invite Muhammad Musalla, the representative of the Director General of ISISCO, who have been our partners throughout this enterprise, to give some concluding reflections on what we have done in the last 3 days. So please come forward.
بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على محمد رسول الله وعلى إخوانه رسول الله أجمعين أحييكم وأدعو لكم أحييكم سلاما سلاما وأدعو لكم أسعد الله مساءكم أها نحن قد شرفنا على اختتام هذا المؤتمر المهم وقد وفقنا بحمد الله وتوفيقه إلى أن نسهم في هذه البداية الجديدة التي نتغياها ونهدف إليها خدمة للعلاقة الإسلامية الأمريكية. وفقنا في الإسهام في هذه البداية لأسباب عدة، أولها لتنوع المحاور التي ناقشناها من حوار الأديان إلى التنوع الثقافي إلى المرأة إلى التعليم إلى التكنولوجيا إلى فلسطين، قطب الرحى في هذه العلاقة، والتي قال معالي المدير العام في الكلمة التي وجهها إلى المؤتمر بأنها كانت السبب في تغير النظرة، نظرة العالم الإسلامي إلى الولايات المتحدة الأمريكية بسبب الدعم الأمريكي اللامشروط لإسرائيل وللاحتلال الإسرائيلي وللممارسات الإسرائيلية منذ قرار تقسيم وإنشاء إسرائيل. وأنا أقول بأن حل القضية الفلسطينية وعمل إدارة أوباما على حل هذه القضية سيعيدنا من جديد إلى أن ننظر إلى الولايات المتحدة مثلما كان ينظر إليها آباؤنا وأجدادنا على أنها موطن الأحرار وبلاد الشجعان، دون أن تتحرر فلسطين من هذا العدوان الإسرائيلي والذي كان على الدوام بدعم أمريكي لا يمكن أن أصف أي طرف يدعم الاحتلال أن أصفه بأنه طرف حر. هذا أول. خطاب السيد أوباما في القاهرة وفي إسطنبول كان خطابا جيدا مهما نحس فيه بتغيير كبير في الخطاب السياسي تجاه قضايا العالم الإسلامي، وبالتالي حتى ننصف الرجل وحتى لا نزايد عليه، على مستوى الخطاب تمت تغير 100% ما بين الإدارتين السابقة والحالية، لا مجال للمقارنة بين رئيس حالي ينظر إلى الإسلام وإلى القيم الإسلامية وإلى الثقافة الإسلامية والحضارة الإسلامية بكل تلك الإيجابية وبين رئيس سابق كان يتحدث عن الفاشية الإسلامية وهو الفاشي الذي مارس فاشيته في العراق وفي أفغانستان. لا يمكن أن نقارن بين رئيس ينظر إلى القضية الفلسطينية على أن المشكلة فيها والأصل فيها هو الاحتلال، وبين رئيس سابق ينظر إلى أن الأصل في المشكلة وفي هذه القضية هم هؤلاء العرب والمسلمين، ولا يعترف بأن أرضهم مغتصبة وبأنهم حين يفعلون ما يفعلون ويقولون ما يقولون هم يفعلون هذا من أجل الشرعية الدولية. العرب والفلسطينيون والمسلمون هم يطالبون بتنفيذ قرار تقسيم وغيره من القرارات من قرارات الشرعية الدولية، ودعونا نقولها بصراحة المجحفة في حق الفلسطينيين، ومع ذلك نتحدث بأننا نطالب بحل عادل مع علمنا أن هذا الحل الذي نطالب به هو ليس حلا عادلا، سنأخذ أقل من نصف فلسطين ومع ذلك نرضى بهذا. لكن لا حياة لمن تنادي مع الأسف، الإعلام قلب كل الحقائق، وحين تتحدث عن حقيقة الصراع وعما يجب أن يفعل قد توصف باللا واقعية أو لست أدري. نستبشر خيرا بخطاب هذا الرئيس الجديد، مع أنه مضى سنة ونصف عليه، مع ذلك يبقى جديدا بحكم أن الرجل في فترة أولى، أن سنة ونصف في الحكم ليست كافية لنقول بأنه قضى وقتا كافيا بأن يغير تغييرا دراماتيكيا في سياسة أمريكا الشرق أوسطية قضية المستوطنات كانت مواقفه جيدة، عين مبعوثا موضوعيا منصفا. السيد رشاد تحدث عن جهود الإدارة الأمريكية في هذا، وأنا أقول هي جهود جيدة ولكنها غير كافية. حتى نعزز هذه العلاقة الأمريكية، حتى نعيدها إلى وضعها الصحيح، حتى نضعها على القاطرة الصحيحة، أعتقد أنه يجب أن تنبني هذه العلاقة على الاحترام المتبادل، على رعاية المصالح المشتركة، على احترام القانون الدولي وقرارات الشرعية الدولية. وأعتقد أن هذا المؤتمر، وأنا أستغل هذه المناسبة لأشكر دكتور سراج الدين على اختيار هذا العنوان المهم، بحيث لم نعد فقط نتحدث عن الشق السياسي والاقتصادي في تعزيز العلاقات الإسلامية الأمريكية، وإنما أيضا نتحدث عن مقاربة جديدة، عن دمج الثقافة والتعليم والتربية والعلوم طبعا مع السياسة والاقتصاد في دعم هذه العلاقة. لماذا هذه المقاربة مهمة؟ لأنها تشتغل على قطاع التربية والثقافة، تشتغل على بناء الفكر، على إعادة هندسة المخاييل. حين نتحدث عن ثقافة، نحن ننتقل من اللاوعي الموجود الآن في العلاقات الإسلامية الأمريكية، وخاصة في ذهن الكثير من أفراد الشعوب الإسلامية والشعوب الأمريكية والشعب الأمريكي في نظرة بعضهما إلى البعض. نتحدث عن صراع بين التمثلات بين العالم الإسلامي وأمريكا مع الأسف. الصراع الموجود الآن ليس صراع حضارات كما ادعى البعض، كما ادعى دعاة صدام الحضارات وجنرالات حروب الأفكار والأيديولوجيات، وإنما هو صراع بين التمثلات. كل طرف يتمثل ثقافة الآخر على غير حقيقتها مع الأسف الشديد. وهذه الثنائية هي ثنائية قاتلة، من منطلق أنها تنبني على أن كل طرف لا تتحدد ثقافته إلا عبر نفي الآخر. نحن نريد أن نتحدث عن تعارف بين الحضارات. القرآن الكريم يقول: يا أيها الذين آمنوا إن خلقناكم من ذكر وأنثى وجعلناكم شعوبا وقبائل لتعارفوا. خلقناكم من ذكر وأنثى، تنوع جنسي، وجعلناكم شعوبا وقبائل، تنوع ديني وثقافي وعرقي وحضاري، لتعارفوا. الأصل فيكم هو التنوع، وليس مطلوبا أن تكونوا على نمط واحد، وإنما أن تتعارفوا. والتعارف يشترك في اللغة العربية في جذره اللغوي مع المعرفة. التعارف الحقيقي يجب أن يكون مؤسسا على معرفة حقيقية. التفاهم بين الشعوب والحضارات يجب أن يتأسس على الفهم أولا. نحن مع الأسف ما زلنا لحد الآن لم نفهم بعضنا بعضا بالشكل الذي يجب أن يكون عليه الأمر. بالتالي أرى أهمية اختيار هذا العنوان، والدكتور سراج الدين ومساعديه وفقوا في هذا الأمر، والإسيسكو لأنها تعرف هذه الحصافة من المكتبة ومن السيد مديرها دعمت هذه الندوة، وستسعى دائما إلى الانخراط في كل الجهود التي تقرب بين الشعوب وبين الثقافات، والتي تصلح ما أفسده ليس الظهر وإنما ما أفسدته السياسات مع الأسف. لا مشكلة لدينا مع القيم الأمريكية كما يريد البعض أن يوهمنا، مشكلتنا كما قلنا مع سياسات متراكمة. لا مسؤولية الإدارة الحالية فيها، لكن مسؤولية الإدارة الحالية أن تساهم معنا في تغييرها، ومطلوب منها هذا من أجل عالم متعايشة شعوبه، متعارفة ثقافاته، متحالفة حضاراته. قد كنا دائما كعرب وكمسلمين مع حق الشعوب في الاستقلال. سأطرح السؤال على أصدقائنا الأمريكيين: من فيكم يعلم ما هي أول دولة اعترفت باستقلال الولايات المتحدة الأمريكية؟ أنا سألت أمريكيين. Morocco, thank you. المغرب بلد عربي إسلامي. بمجرد إعلان الاستقلال لأننا نؤمن بحق الشعوب في تقرير مصيرها وفي نيل حريتها وفي محاربة كل احتلال بادر المغرب في نفس السنة إلى الاعتراف باستقلال الولايات المتحدة الأمريكية وأرسلت الولايات المتحدة الأمريكية بعثتها إلى مدينة طنجة قنصلية أول قنصلية أمريكية كانت في مدينة طنجة هذه المدينة المغربية الساحلية الجميلة شأنها في ذلك شأن أغلب المدن المغربية الجميلة من هذا أنا أنطلق لأقول بأن الأمة التي تدعم حق الآخر على اختلافه معها في أن يستقل وفي أن يقرر مصيره أحرى بها أن تدعم جزءا من كيانها في أن يستقل وأن يتحرر من ربقة الاحتلال والاستعمار نحن مع سلام عادل شامل المبادرة العربية الآن مطروحة إسرائيل ترفضها الولايات المتحدة تريدها لكن إسرائيل تصر على إحراج الإدارة الأمريكية وتصر على الإساءة للعلاقات الإسلامية الأمريكية وتصر على أن تورط الإدارة الأمريكية حتى لا يستطيع الرئيس أوباما أن يفي بالتزاماته تجاه العالم الإسلامي الولايات المتحدة الآن أن تعي مع من مصلحتها هل مع 1,300,000 مسلم أم مع طغمة متطرفة محتلة لا تريد الخير لا للولايات المتحدة ولا لغيرها حتى أولئك الذين يدعمون إسرائيل في الولايات المتحدة الأمريكية بدافع ديني الأصولية الإنجيلية أو الصهاينة المسيحيين باتر بيرتسون وجيري فالويل وغراهام وغيرهم ليس حبا في إسرائيل وإنما هو دعم تكتيكي من أجل تلك الخزعبلات التي يؤمنون بها حتى يعودوا إلى أرض الميعاد ليتحارب معسكر الخير ومعسكر الشر بين قوسين في معركة هرمجدون حتى ينزل المسيح عليه السلام ويحكم 1,000 سنة السعيدة معسكر الشر أيضا هذا فيه الكثير من اليهود إذن دعم الإنجيليين لليهود ليس استراتيجيا وإنما هو تكتيكي نعتقد أن هذا التطرف الديني وأنا هنا أتحدث عنه أعتقد أن قصدي كان واضحا حتى لا ينسب التطرف إلى دين معين كل الثقافات كل أديان لابد أن ترى أن تجد فيها أفرادا متطرفين لكن يلبسون عباءة الدين ورداء الدين ليحققوا مصالحهم الدين أي دين منزه عن دعم الإرهاب وعن دعم التطرف وعلينا جميعا من كل الأديان أن نحارب المتطرفين في كل الثقافات هؤلاء أقلية ونحن أغلبية لكن مع الأسف نحن أغلبية صامتة وهم يتحدثون بلغة السلاح وبلغة الحرب وبلغة التفجيرات وبلغة الاحتلال وعلينا أن نحاربهم أشكركم جزيلا على مشاركتكم في إنجاح هذا المؤتمر ونتمنى أن نلتقي قريبا إن شاء الله في مؤتمر آخر نقيم فيه ما تدرسناه ونحلل فيه ما يجب أن نفعله ونستشرف مستقبل هذه العلاقة التي نأمل أن تكون كما نريد نحن وكما يريد السيد أوباما من خلال ما عبر عنه السيد مبعوثه الخاص أشكركم أشكر مكتبة الإسكندرية أشكر السيد رشاد حسين السلام عليكم ورحمة الله تعالى وبركاته
شكرا للأخ كريم محمد بن صلاح شكرا للأخ رشاد حسين Thank you both for those reflections We are a little bit over time and we revisited a few of the issues that were present as somebody said at the beginning an elephant in the room and my friend Rashad, my friend Muhammad, both said, well, there is an elephant in the room and we have to deal with it. I was hoping to say, yes, there is an elephant, but let's put him out of the room for a moment so that we can continue to talk about something else. But anyway, we have covered it with, I think, commendable honesty. And I believe that what we heard from Rashad and what we heard from Muhammad show that we each heard the other, which is important. And I think, Mr. Rashad Hussein, you can carry back a very important message from all of us and from Mr. Nsalah, who I think expressed very much the feelings of many, is that people have been deeply touched by the actions and discourse of President Obama. And that people in this part of the world and throughout, because we have representatives all the way from Indonesia to Morocco and Nigeria in this room, so people from all over have high hopes for what he can do to restore what we think should be a just and lasting peace, and that we are willing to be realistic. As Muhammad bin Salah said, we're talking about a just peace within the constraints of international agreed resolutions, which means that the Palestinians would get far less than half of Palestine, but it would be a secure state. And thus, we hope very much that the excellent start that has been done will again lead to good results here. As someone who follows American politics closely, I was very pleased with an analogy that you used, which is that sometimes when looking at healthcare, a lot of people who have seen the battles for healthcare, I lived in the United States for over 3 decades, I've seen these battles come and go, and it looked like an impossible task. For quite a while, it seemed that nothing would go through. And yet, somehow, at the end, despite all the odds, despite all the appearances, the president was able to fulfill his promise to his electorate, because that was part of his campaign promises. So I think all of us believe the president, President Obama, believe his sincerity, believe his goodwill, and we recognize the difficulty of the obstacles. But I think that he should also know, as I think he does, the extent and deep-rooted feelings of alienation, of anger. I think you have heard from some of the leaders of the Muslim world, because the Mufti in Egypt, the Mufti in Bosnia, the Vice Rector of the Islamic International University in Pakistan, I mean, these are all leaders of Muslim thought. The true breadth and openness of Islam. And I think you know that anyway, but we are delighted that the discourse in the United States is changing, that there will be a formal, so to speak, movement towards this abolition of stereotypes that is building obstacles. But we, too, in our part of the world, have to be committed to fight stereotypes of the ugly American, to fight the stereotypes of an America that is out of touch and unwilling to change. I think Mufti Sheikh Ali Goma pointed out that people would say it will be impossible for a black man to be elected in the United States. Well, guess what? It happened. And people had said also, well, there will never be a woman elected president of the United States. Not true. The runner-up to President Obama for the nomination was a woman. So the Democratic Party, was, if it hadn't been President Obama, it would have been President Clinton. So the second President Clinton. But and people say, what is the status of women in the Muslim world? Well, guess what? Four of the largest countries in the Muslim world have already elected women heads of government. We've had Indonesia, we've had Bangladesh, we've had Pakistan, and we've had Turkey, all of whom have had women heads of state. So maybe, like the joke I started with in this session about who's not hearing whom, whether she said for the third time spaghetti and he wasn't hearing her, maybe we need to hear each other a little bit better. And I believe that we have done a lot in this way, and I am not going to list all the projects that we have already started talking about, but I promise you I'll send them to each and every one of you. But before I close, I want you to join me in expressing a vote of thanks to a particular team of very devoted people who have been working very hard to make this conference possible. I'm not going to cite all the people from the print shop, to the secretary, to the security people, to the drivers, to the musicians, to the organizers, the secretariat, and so on. But I would like to single out three who have led this conference from the beginning till now. And to them we owe a thanks, and through them we thank also all their team that worked with them. And they are Dr. Mohsen Youssef, Heba Rafai, and Sameh Fawzi. Please convey our thanks to every member of the team, because if I start citing names now, I'm sure to forget some, and that would be problematic. It would be another occasion where I would hurt somebody unintentionally, and I would have to apologize for that again. Now, my friends, where do we go from here? I think what we have all come to do here is to make sure that we had the real actions that will come out of this. I have counted no less than 18 proposals. Now, I've sort of been around 18 very concrete proposals that we can follow on. Some have already started, others are about to start, others are just ideas being formulated. I am sure there are more. And we will reach out with our friends in ISESCO, in the US government, in the US institutions, and try to ensure that the cores that have started all these projects, in fact, continue to receive our support, our blessing, and all our encouragement, and that if others can join them, so much the better. And with that, I hope that you've all enjoyed your visit to Alexandria, to Egypt, and to the Bibliotheca Alexandrina. And I thank you all for having made this conference what it is, and I wish you Godspeed and safe journeys.